The more we love Christ, the more we know his nature and how he wants us to live. The more we want to impress him. To be pure and blameless? Well, that's the goal. Alright, how many of you know what we ask? Okay, so the whole live pure and blameless, that's the goal, okay? Now, number four, living a pure and blameless love. What this church, and I'm not talking about fellow wife, what this church needs is to continue to grow in our love for Jesus and each other. That's the adventure. To grow in our love for Jesus and our love for each other. To lead lives of purity so that no one can point a finger at us and say, you shouldn't be doing that. You're a Christian. You should be doing that. We can't love without the Spirit of Christ in us. I mean, that's evident. Scripture is very clear on that. You really cannot love the way God wants you to love unless the love of God is in you. Read 1 John 4:7-8. The more we love Christ, the more we can love others. That's the way it works. The more we love Christ, the more we can love others. Love works like a flame. It really does. It's not a blunt force that causes change in a person, but a consistent flame of God's love in our lives that melts down the irresistible forces in front of us. Let me share a story with you. There's an old fable that tells how different instruments try to master a piece of iron. The blows of the axe fell heavily, but its edge became more and more blunt. The saw's relentless teeth worked until they were worn down or broken. The hammer's head flew off on the first stroke. Despite all their efforts, the iron remained. Finally, the flame curled gently around the iron, embraced it, and never left until the iron melted under its irresistible influence. Love can melt hardened hearts and keep the Spirit of Christ in his church. Love can melt the hardest hearts. So, the journey begins. And here's what I want to suggest for us as we start this 40-day spiritual adventure. Again, we don't start until next Sunday, so don't get anxious on it. Don't start praying or reading your Bible or any of that stuff. Yeah, please do. But the idea is to really get into this concept of learning how and praying a prayer for this church. Okay? So pray the prayer daily. Could you show us the prayer? I'm so glad you got it. There we go. I've actually been praying this the last several weeks in our service, but I'd like for you to listen to it as I pray it out loud. Dear Jesus, help us as a church to love much and to love well. Help us to learn to love appropriately and intelligently, to live this life of love, circumspect, and being a living example to others, demonstrating how to love like fill our hearts with your Spirit, that we may see the fruit of your Spirit growing in us. May we all live in such a way so that it glorifies your name and inspires others to want to worship you. In your precious name, Jesus the Christ. Amen. That's basically taking that text and praying it out loud. And I want to challenge you to pray it every day. This is based upon the message, paraphrase of it, but I think it really speaks to us and where we need to go. The adventure is deepening our love for God and each other. And so to ask the Holy Spirit again, to ask the Holy Spirit to move in us and teach us how to love, that's going to be a profound thing. And if all of us did it every day, think of what a profound change it would make in us as a church. Alright, now, daily devotions. I know many of you have daily devotions, and I applaud that. I'm so grateful for you doing that, because you know the value of it. Some of you, like I said, kind of it's hit or miss. I want you to take the challenge of doing it every day. Next week, I'll be handing out a daily devotion for your There are a couple of paragraphs, and then there's a prayer. So it's not like you're reading three sermons a day off. Even if you feel you disagree with me, at least you are spending time in the presence of Christ thinking about love for others. Right? So that's the goal. Now, last but not least, setting a bonfire. Setting a spiritual, you like the bonfire in the background there? It says people. Did you know that a bonfire is defined as a large open air fire? It is used for warmth, entertainment, celebration, or for getting rid of leaves and garbage. I think today I'm hoping and praying that we will build a spiritual bonfire in us through the Holy Spirit. Yes, it's for entertainment and warmth and celebration, but it's also for getting rid of the garbage in our lives as well. And so, fire is often a sign of God's glory and the presence in the Old Testament. Fire is often seen as a cleansing form of judgment and revelation. We need a new flame of passion for Christ in us as a church. To feel the Holy Spirit's power and presence every time we gather. In the 40-day journey, I'm praying for God's Holy Spirit to be revived in us, for it to burn so bright that it seems like a spiritual bonfire. Amen. So let me take that idea of love, learn, and live. And I'm playing with it on this last one here. Love to learn to live. Learn to live to love. Live to love to learn. Ponder that, maybe. Think about it. Love to learn to live. Learn to live to love. And live to love to learn. This whole thing is called love, learn, live. That's what I'm just calling that. Because Paul says, I want you to love much and love well. I want you to learn to love intelligently. And I want you to live a lover's life circumspectly with great passion. And I think that's my goal for us as a church. Will this draw thousands of people into our building? No. But it may prepare us for the next step. I truly believe God has something for us. And so I want us to think about how we're going to serve each other. I want us to be thinking about how God's calling us to be a light in this dark community. And I think God wants us to do some unique and wonderful things. We need to love. We need to learn. And we need to live. I'd like to invite the worship team.